So this is the part two of the STEAM lecture. This is week nine. We covered all the basics about STEAM systems, and this is imparting configuration for the STEAM. And here we have the 1.5 STEAM pump. What we mean by pump is not gravity fit. We collect all the water. So you see the steam coming out of the boiler? It goes out the top, coming back into the bottom of each mattress, and we have one pipe. So the steam will come in here, the air will vent slowly until it fills up, and you'll hear the mattress hissing. It fills up with steam, it starts to exchange the heat with the wall of the radiator, make sure it will give off heat. And if you notice, those mattresses have really thick metal, which is good. Why is that good? It will store heat, has more inertia. If anybody of you cook, you know that thick pan is better than thin pans. That doesn't make a big difference. If you get a frying pan thick, it will store more heat. So for some, if you do some pancakes or some crepes or something, you want the pan to store the heat, then you cook with the residual heats. Pizza, if you cook pizza at home, fine. The best way to cook pizza is to use a stone, right? A stone will, you heat the stone, you turn off the oven, and you cook the pizza on the stone. There's a characteristic of the heat distribution coming out from the plate that come from the convection. Also, speaking of heat, pizza ovens, usually they fire the oven for like at least an hour or two, completely heated, then they leave a little bit of coal in the corner and that's it. You're cooking with the residual heats. So this is what we do with the steam. It has very thick metal to absorb the heat. That's why it takes a little bit longer to start showing some heat. And this section will heat first, then this section, and this section all the way. The steam will keep filling up until it kicks all the air out. Then suddenly you start seeing the heat. And when you turn it off, it will still give off some heat little by little. So the air is out, water starts to accumulate. What is the rate? 1 pound of water for each 1,000 BTU. And you start a flow from the same valve coming all the way down.
Right.
So the water will flow, so it goes down. We have a steam trap over here, in case we have a mixture of steam coming in there. You only allow water to come down, and each one of them will collect the water and make a water tank. And this water is pumped into the boiler. And probably you need to be pumped because it will be lower level where you have more water coming in.
So what was that? 1 pound of water equals what?
Huh?
1 pound of
BTU. 1,000 BTU. And it's better if you say condensate, because you'll know it's not just water, it's condensated water from the steam. And this is the 1.5 system. It's this piping. One of the most important part in this system is the pitch. If you notice, there is a small pitch here. It's hardly noticed, but there is a little pitch down. Because you want to drain the water completely, you don't want to have any residual water. Otherwise, you'll have what's called a water handling. If you overfill, if you look at any steam boiler, you'll see a line that says maximum level, minimum level. You want to be in the middle. If you fill over the maximum, what will happen? You'll have more accumulation of water in the pipes, and you start creating a lot of knocking. So you go and drain some water out.
Is that what's happening in the hallway right now?
Yeah, the pitch is not really correct. So some water is staying in the middle. It's buckling down when it's heated. It's quite a lot of skills and expertise, because you don't know how the pipe is reacting when it's hot. Mm-hmm. It's going to bulge, how the way is going to be. So you have to see it in action. Try to determine where the water is staying. So the steam is moving really fast, and it's pushing the water with it, and with it, it will crack and compress. So this is how it operates again. Water comes out. This is for the 1.5 system. You need to have a vent. So the vents are required in most 1.5 system, because you need a way to vent the air. Air comes out, the steam takes over, start having to condensate, and eventually you'll fill the entire radiator with steam. For the 2.5 system, supply is higher, and air will go bottom. Because again, steam will take over from the top, it will fill out the space, and the air will come out completely. And this has an air vent in it as well. But the reason we put the riser is the incoming pipe at the top of the two pipe system is because we don't want any water to go back into the system. So the water will only come from here. Meanwhile, for the one pipe system, we put it in the left. This is the cause of water hammering. Steam moves fast. It has a lot of energy, so it agitates the water as it moves around. And eventually, you have a bucket of air trapped in the middle. As it gets pushed around, it will eventually pop. Just like when you have a small balloon and you pop it. And of course, depending on the energy of the steam, how fast the water is going, if the water is stagnant, or if the water is flowing away a little bit too much. And again, that's why designing a steam system requires a lot of finesse, requires a lot of expertise. How big is the pipe? How big is the system? How much water do I have? Is the water half full of water? Is the pipe half full of water? Or just a little bit? How much do you want out of it? You don't want it to be as full as this. It's supposed to be 1/4 tops of a flow. How much heat are we giving off of the steam? That's why we need to know how much condensate is coming out. So I know how many condensate, how many BTUs. For example, if I have a room that requires 4,000 BTU hour, how many condensate per hour do I expect? How many pounds? 4 pounds. Four. So 4 pounds is coming out of that radiator. So I think I'm going to collect to different pipes. Can I join two pipes together, or should I have it have its own pipe, otherwise it will fill up? So this is how you use that number to know how to prevent having water hammers. How much should I collect for time? Question.
And what is that number again?
For each 1,000 BTU, you have one pound of condensate, which is half a liter. So I think this is 1 pound. This is half a liter, this is a pound of water, a bottle. You have a visual. Okay, radiator selection. Again, the magic number is 240, ADR. These are some examples of radiators. This looks similar to the one we saw before. The one for type A and type B radiators. We have different flow rate. This is pound per hour, depending on the steam, and how much BTU does it give off per foot. This is just an example. Let's look at this for example. So this is radiator came from a radiator, and they gave you a section number. Section means how many rows and the length. These are just examples. I'm not going to use them. I have another one that I want to use here. But I posted some kind of a pamphlet online for that on Blackboard just for reference. What I want you to know is every radiator shape has its own EDR. They're not all the same. So when you get square foot of radiation, they have at least different, at least 4 or 5 tables for them. Depending on the arrangement, the height, the size. So they go by size and they give you different emission. Some of them, this one can use for steam and hot water. So it looks like a tube. We have some of them here in the shop.
Do you really have one that have 230 degrees like that?
Yeah, if you have steam.
That's kind of hot, isn't it?
That's steam. That's for steam. It's not going to be water. So if you notice, this is for steam and hot water. So the same radiator can operate both. You can put hot water to it or you can put steam.
Do you use steam for like residential applications?
Yeah, we have it now. It's everywhere.
Majority of buildings have steam.
A lot of buildings have steam. If you want to go see steam in action, building 16, you'll see
steam in action right now.
Yeah, but this one with the convectors, it's faster. It's like kind of a little bit modernized. But see the old like historical ones, they're building 16. They're at least like 60 years old. They're very nice. They're very expensive to replace. Very expensive to replace. Very expensive to purchase because they have a lot of metal, and they withstand a lot of.
Everybody's scrapping for metal.
Yeah. And it's very well made, the cast iron. Some of them have steel in it, so it does not rust as fast. But you can go to 230, and it's how much heat you're gonna give off per foot. We have a couple of these cast iron radiators. They're very heavy. They radiate a lot of heat, but the advantage is you can go with a lot of temperature in it. different sections. This goes with the more section. I think I have pictures here. One bar system again. It's the same picture. This one, one is pump with no, one without a pump. But what I want you to notice here is the pitch. You don't want the pitch to be too high or too low. I think
quarter it's bubble, huh? 10 feet. Quarter bubble, 10 feet.
How many degrees is that?
I don't know, but that's the normal quarter it's, bubble. When, yeah. when you take a level, you take your bubble, you put a quarter bubble on the line,
yeah.
10 feet run. That's where the water should drain on all drainage.
It's 10 or 15 degrees, I think. But that's a good rule to think about. So think of the traps here. Make sure everything is pitched. That's something you have to understand. And if you look at the system here, all the water is going to collect in the system, and eventually to go through the Hartford loop and fill in the boiler. Yeah.
Why they don't use second line for the water?
They can. Same pipe. Same pipes configuration, and also the mattress design.
So I want.
And this is older actually. It's an older system. Yeah.
Same pipe, but during the steam action, it's creating heat. During the condensation action, it's allowing it to drain back into the boiler.
No, it's doing it simultaneously. So the same pipe has steam in it and it has water.
Yeah.
One coming, one going.
Okay.
And the top of the pipe, there's steam, and the bottom, there's water. So it's very kind of cool in a way. So use the same pipe for the whole thing. But this is this came earlier.
Mm-hmm.
For, and if you notice, this is a gravity system. And in this system, you don't even need a pump. You need any control. This system can run sufficiently without even electricity. You have a boiler, actually, the first boiler you saw, in the bottom it was a coil boiler. There's nothing in any control. Everything is mechanical. You fire it up with some coil and just keep it going. So you can keep throwing stuff in it. And it's very, very self-sufficient. No electricity whatsoever. The pump is similar. One header to get all the pipes. You have no problems with it. You have a bigger pipe here. You have a tank to collect all the condensate, and it goes directly to the boiler. Two pipes. Again, we try to fill the water all the way to the Hartford loop, and this is going to be the minimum. So you know this is the level of the water you want. This is the minimum. And this is the side glass, and you want the water to be in the middle. That's the normal operating water. And so when you fill the system, it should be in the middle. Once in a while, whatever you seep out of the radiator should be made up from all the leaks. I have to fill my radiator with at least 2 gallons every 3 months. It's not a lot. I don't use a lot of feet, but he's usually 60 kind of, so I use a lot. Notes. So, the pressure in residential steam system is not to exceed 2 psig. That's gauge. So remember this number. I always see it in all burn exams. 2 psi is the maximum. You want to shoot for half a psi as the cut in. You want to keep the system at half a psi, maximum 2 psi. All vents are required for both one pipe and two pipe system. You have to have an air vent in it. If you don't have an air vent, you're going to have accumulated pressure. A lot of popping, you might break something. So you need air vents in all systems, not only one pipe system. Vents are installed in the radiator at the end of the steam riser. What is the riser? The supply line, that's the riser. The riser is the supply of steam line.
But on a two-pipe system, it's not on a riser.
It's still in the riser.
Isn't it? So you got a pipe coming into the radiator up high,
yeah,
right? And then you get the drain pipe that's down lower.
Yeah.
Then you got the vent there, the steam vent.
No, but the vent, steam vent, that's for the steam trap.
Mm-hmm.
But the vent has to be in the riser side.
Okay.
If the steam system is operating with too much water, this could result in water hammering and banging. Again, we saw why, because there's too much water. It's filling up and water is being trapped with some steam. Traps allow the water and air to pass through, and it will stop steam from going through. So the trap will let the air comes out, stop steam, and we let water pass. So it's closed, the water will pass naturally, no pressure required, and the air will, and the steam will be stopped. And so always consult the manufacturer when you try to do an installation of steams, and you might have to. Given the fact that we have a lot of systems now that are steam, consult the manufacturer in terms of the pressure and the requirement and what are the limitations of that boiler. Feed pump has to be float operated to prevent the pump from running on dry. Something to remember. Did you work with condensate pumps at all? You know what they look like. It's kind of similar to that. So it will only work with if there's water. It has a float in it. The float will turn on and off. No water should not be turned off. No pump should be run dry anyway, but some of them can tolerate running dry more than others. Makeup water line must be installed to add water to the system whenever it's needed. Automatic makeup water can be installed with larger system because we don't want to keep going every day and filling up the water. What does that mean? We put a line coming from the municipal water line with a float in it. Whenever the water is low, it will open up and fill.
Why couldn't you just use a condensate pump?
But it's a different application. The water is going to be really hot. Condensate pump is designed for cold water. The heat will not make function.
You mean you mean unheated water. We don't use cold, right? We don't use the word cold, right?
Not hot. Lukewarm.
Plus,
what is the word lukewarm?
Star Wars.
Star Wars?
Lukewarm water. Hot fuel loop must be installed in return online on any steam boiler to prevent water from leaking from the boiler in case of a steam back pressure or leak in the wind system. This is again to maintain the water in the pressure. So if you were asked what is the purpose of hot fuel loop is to maintain the water level in the system, not because the system can run out of water, it's because sometimes you have some back pressure and you might push the steam out of the boiler completely. Then we set the control, low water cutoff, high pressure cutoff, current switch, and primary controls. Okay, here's some examples. This is the cast iron radiator, and this can be used again for hot water and steam. Of course, different temperature. It's very expensive, very durable, it gives off a lot of heat. So let's do some calculations, see how those are calculated. How do we do the EDR? So it gives you the square foot of EDR. And what is the EDR? How much we use?
240.
So this is a cast iron radiator, a cast iron baseboard radiator that is 2.5 inches and 10 inches. So size is always important now. We're not doing the same thing as these elements, where the element is one size. No, we have different sizes that goes by the area. The area of the entire apparatus. So here we have 2.5 times 10, what is 6 feet long. How much speed does it give? And this is the cast iron. Give you the height and the width, so there's a limitation. If it's water or higher, it's going to be different calculation. So I want to know how much this will give me. So let's see. What is the EDR?
240 BTU.
What is the ADR?
3.4
times. Actually, this will make a computer so I'll switch this. How many? 6 feet. What do you get? Question the numbers.
Okay.
I'm getting 4,000.
896?
Make sense? A little bit? So what we look for is that ADR, and we just convert that to BTU. We have the feet, we can find how much heat we're giving off. Okay, this is just a cast iron. Any question about this?
Where do you get the 240 from this equation?
240 is the conversion rate between ADR and BTU. It's always going to be 240. And I think I put that in your cheat sheet.
That's just going to be in like all problems.
Do you have the formula sheet?
Yeah.
Yeah, the 240 is a problem.
Good job. And a star?
So the 2.5.
I want a star. I want a star.
See it.
So the 2.5 times 10 has nothing to do with that at all?
That's just to confirm the size. Because this table will give you the size.
That's just saying it's.
Otherwise, if it's bigger, it will change. Unlike the radiators, it does not change. And if you look here, you see for steam, ADR is 240. I give you the number so you can calculate that, so in case you forget. Different type is a convector. And again, you always have to think about the size. This is 5 inches by 20. How many BTUs does it give if it has 7 sections? So this, you can custom mate by section. You then keep adding sections to it, you can say 5 or 7 sections. It's very convenient, again, because these things are very expensive. So you always get whatever you need. So this is a convector. And again, the names are various. Convectors, I heard mattresses, radiators, what else? They have different names. Based on the shape.
Do you deduct for the plumbing in between the two of them?
What do you mean? No.
So how you connect them? You like,
Wow, why would you do that?
Because you do it on a pipe curve.
No, this
is. You add and deduct for.
If you were at, but this is really small, and they give you the when they give you the convector, they give you per section for the entire thing. So, you want to add for the pipe inside?
Well, let's say you got a room this size, right? So you got a radiator over there, then you got another radiator over there.
Yeah.
So you're not going to lose no heat loss between those two radiators?
No. You don't, you accommodate for the steam coming into here.
Okay.
Steam is steam at that temperature. again, they assume it's residential, so it's going to be at 0.5 to 0.2, so it's been designed to operate at that kind of steam pressure. So let's look at this one, for example, here. And we'll see, so 5 and 20. Which is this one. So we have two types, 5 and 20. And so the BTU. Times the magic number, 240 times. And if you look here, this is per section. How many sections?
Seven.
It should give me the number. What do we got? We got 3,780. Complete lookup. Just don't forget what you're getting here is ADR, so you convert that to BTU by 240. And you just count the sections. And please try to pay close attention to what it says in the table. What are they defining it? What they're giving you their width for a reason, and they give you per section, so we know what they mean. And we'll see as we progress, it gets a little bit involved, but it's the same idea. You done with this? this one, steam converter, this time is 7.5 and 20. So we have this one here, second one, 7.5 and 20. What changed now is the square foot of EER. It will be, what is the number?
3.4.
3.4 times what?
240.
240.
Times 7.
And 7 sections. What do we get?
5,712.
Questions?
How long would that radiator be?
Huh?
How long would the radiator be at 7 sections?
Probably.
How big is this section?
I think 6 sections, 2 inches.
Doesn't fall over.
Yeah, no, 2 inches. And as you notice, again, the way they calculate this heat loss, and the reason they have the EDR is they put it in a box and try to cut the base on how much heat we're giving off. There's a lot goes in because they have different shapes. And the different shapes has to do, again, how to make the maximum radiation out of with the smallest size possible. And they were very efficient. Just think about it, you get a lot of heat out of this. Okay. This is what's called tubular, the tubular radiators. And this one's called power. So, I've seen these in action, and I've seen this other one as well. Same thing, let's do this example. Anybody done with this?
Sure.
So, 4, 2, tubular radiator. So if you look here, they go by height, number of tubes, so there's variation, and you can custom made, custom order those. They have some on shelf, but you can't order them. No, putting them together is not that expensive, just like putting those together. You can buy a machine that put these for you. You buy the tube, you buy the casing, and as you can tell, it's all the same. Put the support, as far as you go, and there's a machine that put those little slides
in there.
Yeah. They make it here at Mestec. They make a lot of those radiators here. And they also print their own boards. So let's do this one. 4-tube radiator, 20 inch high, 4 tubes, so I have my EDR. So BTU. What is the EDR? Somebody?
Yeah.
Oh, for the first
2.25. Look at it here, right?
Yeah.
Times 240.
Yeah.
Times.
I don't know.
That's it. Yeah, that's it. Not really. Because you got the 4 tubes. So what is the number here?
Oh, 5, wouldn't you times it by 4 though? Because it's 4 tubes.
No, I already gave you. This is the 4 tube.
Count it out.
That's it?
Is that?
So this is the EDR for the 4 tubes.
You sure, 5?
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's but no system's just gonna have 4 tubes.
Yeah, so you can have one slice.
Right.
Yeah. So one slice. So I didn't ask for my slice, but one slice is gonna give you this much. So you keep adding the slices.
So each one is 540 BTU, and you would add for
So this one.
Yeah, I didn't get 540. I got 54,000.
54,000.
Huh? I'm doing exactly what he did.
2.25.
Oh, okay, I got you.
Jesus.
And usually, when we want to design, we actually you order the radiator based on your BTU. So I'm gonna go get my BTU divided by 240, divided by this number, and I'll get how many sections do I need. And again, this is very convenient because you can keep adding sections and you get a small radiator that will heat the entire room. What about this one? 32 tubes, which is going to be here, this one. Six tubes. What is the BTU for that, for one section? What's the number?
Five.
I'll give you 950. Last one. Column already here, 26 height, 26, four columns. That's gonna give me 5. I'll set the section here.
Okay. 24 times 5? Gives you 120. Add an extra zero.
What do you mean? So that's a shape. Different shape, different look, different internal configuration. How smooth the steam will flow. So last one, 26 and 4 tubes. So we'll do a few examples in the afternoon, and we can try to reverse calculate that. How big is the area? Thank you.